So I wanted to introduce all of you in the class to Professor James Meiss, who's in the Department of Applied Mathematics at the University of Colorado and my good colleague and downstairs neighbor. Jim, I know that you're particularly interested in the standard map, and we've been talking lately in the MOOC that I'm teaching about maps. So can you tell us a bit about what the standard map is and what's interesting to you about it?
Sure, I'm happy to talk about my favorite dynamical system, the standard map. So my background is in physics, and the standard map is a good model for some very simple physical systems. So one of them is just imagine that you have a pendulum that would ordinarily be rocking back and forth. If you don't do anything to the pendulum and there's no friction, then it just rocks back and forth at the same amplitude forever and ever and ever. But if somebody over here has a hammer and occasionally, in this situation, gives it a kick periodically, so every time the ball, wherever it happens to be, at t equals 1, the person hits it, and at t equals 2, the person will hit it again wherever it happens to be. The amplitude of the kick is fixed, but the hammer is more effective for different angles than other angles. So the kick will be more effective, say, if the pendulum bob is horizontal, then you get a big kick, and basically ineffective if it's straight down, and give a negative kick if it's over here. The physics of this tells you, just from Newton's equation, that you can reduce this dynamics to a map, a very simple map. Here the angle is represented by this variable x, and the angular momentum is represented by the variable y. And so you end up getting a two-dimensional map that I've written down totally wrong here. Well, there it is. And the dynamics of this system are amazingly complicated. So if the kick is zero, if k, this parameter k, is zero, then the angular momentum is constant. And that's this reflection of effectively the constant amplitude that I was telling you about. But if the kick is non-zero, then you can get complicated dynamics, which sometimes is regular and sometimes is chaotic. And I think the interesting thing about this kind of system, which isn't dissipative, is that there just isn't one typical attractor for the system that is either strange or not strange, but you have an intermixture of some orbits being chaotic and some orbits being regular, all for the same fixed parameter value. So I have written a little program that if you have a Macintosh computer, you can download from my homepage. And if you click on the programs link here, there are several programs actually that I've written about dynamical systems, but one of them is the standard map program. And just download it by clicking on the link here. It runs on most of the recent versions of the operating system for macOS. So when you open the standard map program, you see two windows. One is the face space window and another is a text window. In the phase space window, the horizontal variable is x, which, as I showed you earlier, is the angle of the pendulum, and the vertical variable is y, the angular momentum. And there's one parameter in the system that you can access by this map parameters menu called k. And here I've just set the parameter k equal to 0 as an initial trial. If you click anywhere in the window, you see immediately horizontal lines in the situation. These horizontal lines are actually consist of many, many points. So if I, instead of iterating continuously, go to single step, click on initial condition, you see a square where the initial condition is, and then hitting the space bar shows you one iterate of the map. So the analytical formula says that the new value of x is the old value of x plus whatever y we happen to be at. Here we're at y on the order of 0.3, so we move over on the order of 0.3 in x. And we hit the space bar again, and the color's changed, but the new point is again the same distance horizontally over. Since this is an angle, we wrap x around periodically, and now we're over here someplace. Oops, I think I clicked someplace incorrectly. And if we keep iterating with the space bar, it begins to fill in this horizontal line. And if I go up to this find menu and do continuously, it just fills in a horizontal line that indicates that initial condition. So changing the value of this parameter k to something that's not zero, something positive, then we have a kick. We're kicking the system. Now if I again click somewhere in the window, the dynamical property of the orbit is quite different.
So when you click, Jim, you're setting an initial condition.
Yes, okay. Exactly, setting initial conditions. So the different initial conditions have different behavior. Here, these initial conditions are near x equals zero, which is where the pendulum would be oscillating, and so the range of x is bounded, and the momentum is going positive and negative. So these are oscillatory orbits. And then up here, if I click with an initial condition, the pendulum is going over the top. And the interesting thing is that there are orbits that have a hard time deciding whether they're going to go over the top or oscillate, and that's exactly where chaos starts to appear in this dynamical system. So these are orbits on what we would think of as the separatrix. In the case of an integrable pendulum, this is an orbit where the pendulum starts with the bob vertically at the top. It falls down, crosses the down position, and then goes back up vertically to the top, and if energy is preserved, it just is asymptotic to the top position and stays there. But when we're kicking it, the kick isn't very large here, but we're kicking it a little bit, that results in an orbit that seems to fill a whole region of phase space. It's actually chaotic. If I hit the up arrow key, I can just increment the value of k, and you see that the size of the chaotic region begins to grow. Now, I mentioned before that what's really interesting about these conservative dynamical systems, I think, is that there's an intermixture of chaotic orbits and regular orbits, and so the regular orbits you see here are these islands. And there are lots of islands in the system, and they're caused by what we think of as resonances in the Hamiltonian dynamics. So there's a resonance here, for example, that corresponds to three kicks per period of the of the oscillation.
And this is the kind of resonance that causes planets to have interesting behavior as
exactly,
well.
Exactly, yeah. So if we had a similar resonance between the period of Jupiter and the period of an asteroid, then the asteroid is effectively getting kicked every time it goes near Jupiter and could get kicked out of its orbit. Another interesting thing about the standard map is that there's a progression of bifurcations that cause this chaotic region to grow larger and larger. And then if I make the parameter k, in this case, let me just type it in, on the order of, say, 5, the system becomes almost completely chaotic, except for some smaller regular regions. And if we continue to increase the parameter value k, those regions seem to be going away.
Do they ever completely go away?
No one knows. It's been proved that for any particular value of k, if it's very large, there are arbitrarily close values of k for which there are elliptic orbits, which are these islands. But it seems like if I set k on the order of 10, say, that the system, at least as far as the computer is concerned, is completely chaotic. So we have one orbit here, and it's filling. Every pixel on the screen is gone. So it seems like the orbits fill the entire area available. But if I increase k to be 12 in this situation, 12 point something, then an island appears. So a visible island appears. And there are visible islands that appear for arbitrarily large values of k, too.
So a whole chain of bifurcations, but nothing like the period doubling bifurcation sequence in the logistic map. This is much more complicated.
A different sort of sequence of bifurcations. Yeah.
Another thing that you might be interested in on Jim's homepage is a link to the wonderful book that he's written about dynamical systems.
That's nice of you to say. So I wrote this book for a class that I teach here at the University of Colorado for first-year graduate students in applied math and anybody in engineering or science who's interested in dynamics.
Thanks, Jim.
You're most welcome.
In his lecture, Jim used a couple of terms that we'll talk about later in the semester, so I just wanted to give you a little bit of a forward pointer and quick explanation of those terms. First of all, phase space. This is a synonym for state space. State space is the very powerful representation that we use to describe evolution of trajectories of dynamical systems. It's the space whose axes are the state variables. For the standard map, the state space looks like this. And each point on that state space, like the ones that Jim was putting down by clicking on his app, represent a pair of values for x and y. And the standard map, which Jim was invoking with the click, is a box of mathematics that takes a value for x and a value for y, and tells you where the next point will be. So the action of the standard map
is to evolve the state one step forward in time, as schematized by that red arrow. Of course, the point doesn't actually follow the path of that red arrow. It hops from that one black dot to the other. A separatrix is kind of what it sounds like. It's a curve or a surface in state space that separates two different regions, kind of like the continental divide.
Integrable is a loaded word. It basically means that the system is not chaotic, that the equations cannot be solved in closed form. We'll get back to this in the next unit.
This is another nest of words that we'll talk about later on. Dissipation is a more general term for friction, dissipation of energy, loss of energy, or technically gain of energy. In systems that are conservative, energy is conserved. Okay, those are non-dissipative systems. Hamiltonian is a synonym for conservative. So if I put a non in front of dissipative, those three words are synonyms. Dissipation is a necessary condition for the existence of attractors. In other words, you have to have dissipation for there to be an attractor in your system, because something has to eat up the energy and cause the trajectory to kind of relax down to the fixed point or the limit cycle or the chaotic attractor. So in the logistic map, where the trajectory is relaxing down to a fixed point, that behavior lets you know that the system is dissipative because there's an attractor there. The standard map that Jim was talking about is non-dissipative, so there aren't any attractors, but there's still chaos. So just to sum that up, dissipation, friction, is a necessary condition for the existence of attractors, but not for the existence of chaos. So you can have chaos if you don't have chaotic attractors. I'm not going to do a whole lot of Hamiltonian dynamics in this course because we don't have time, but there's a whole rich field of it, as Jim's lecture, I hope, suggested to you.